we're so glad that you chose to worship with us this morning. We're glad that you're here. If you are a guest with us, we'd love to know that you're here. If you could fill out the little sheet of paper that's in your program, and you could drop it off either in the offering plate as it comes by, or to drop it off at the Welcome Center, which is right as you come in the front doors, and they have a gift for you there. But we're just so glad that you chose to worship with us this morning, and we pray that you would feel welcome here, and that you would also just feel free to just worship in the way that you choose, in the way that the Spirit leads you this morning. So let's just continue to worship, just sing about God's goodness.
With love, wholeheartedly, my soul.
not just words, God, but that we can truly just reflect on the things that we're singing, the truth of who you are that we're singing to about. God, I just pray that we would just hear a word from you this morning, just as you would speak to us. Quiet our hearts to hear your voice, God. I pray that we would learn to surrender our lives to you, and that as we surrender our lives to you, God, that you would continue to build in us your love, your heart, your eyes for the world around us. We worship you in this place. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Awesome. How are y'all doing the fair? Woo! Go left. Right. Here we go. We're good. Awesome. We're glad we have AC, right? Okay, cool. If you have your Bibles, we turn to Matthew chapter 22 and verse 28, a couple other places. But hey, one of the privileges of being a pastor is I get to hear lots of stories and see what God's doing in and through people, and love that. And so some of those stories you can share sometimes you can't share, but I just want to kind of catch you up. It's almost been 2 years since we've been here as the pastor, lead pastor, and so an exciting 2 years. Sometimes it feels like it's been 2 weeks. Sometimes it feels like it's been 20 years. And, you know, it's just those things. You never know. And so, but it's exciting to be here. And there's lots of great things going on. So one of those cool things is this young lady over here that signs for us at 10:15 or 10:30, whatever time we meet. I don't know if you remember what time we meet, Maggie?
9:15, and then we meet again at 10:30.
All right, there you go. See, she talks, too. And so, at 9:15, she teaches a wonderful class called Ken Mar. There's about 60 people that go in there, and they get to hear about Jesus from Maggie. So she signs and teaches in that class. And then Marcia, who is our nursery coordinator, when we first got here, we had one kid in there by the name of Sparrow, and now we have like 20 kids in there. And so Marcia and her team of ladies are in there at 9:15 and 10:30, loving on and taking care of your kids. And so lots of great things happening in that. And then our life groups, we've started life groups and Sunday morning life groups and midweek life groups, and those are blowing up and they're all over the town. So we're going to talk to you about getting in one of those. We constantly talk about getting one of those because that's where church becomes life for you. So get involved in that. And our children's ministry, Awanas, last year there were 175 kids, I think, at the end. Being involved in Awanas, and so that's incredible. The student ministry is growing, and excited about all the different things. And so one of the reasons that I'm telling you that is because you don't always get to hear some of the things that are going on. And so sometimes even numbers can kind of throw you off. So when we first got here, I was told there was 85 to 90 in worship, and over the last few months or whatever, there's been over 300 of you rattling around on a Sunday morning in the building, which is incredible to see what God's doing. So one of the things that I want you to grasp is it's not about numbers, but behind every number is a person, and behind every person is a soul. And so our passion here is to see souls transformed by the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So
man,
that's an exciting thing to be a part of. And so one of our visions, one of our things is that we are super crowded throughout the week doing different things. And so like on Wednesdays in particular, with all these kids rattling around, we can't have students in here. So students, starting this week, right, are going to be at Camp Lone Star, meeting up there while Awanas is going on here. So I know that you got to go back and forth. So again, those are great opportunities for us. It's anytime that we grow, continue to grow and have those things, those are opportunities for us to think through different options. And so one of the most exciting things for me as a pastor over the last 2 years is 60 plus people have been baptized. And that's an exciting thing. That's a life transforming deal. And some of you that were here, maybe that first Sunday that I was here that we baptized, you know, I've been here for a little bit. We did a baptism and had those waders on that I have that I kind of hide back there. And those waders were so new that they had dry rotted. And so I was in there and I had this little mechanism going on and I'm talking and all of a sudden it cuts off and y'all are like, what's going on? And so I just said, hey, listen, my pants are full of water. And so I had filled up and the waders didn't work, but it was an awesome beginning to seeing that. And one of the cool things I think that we're seeing is we're seeing adult men make those decisions, important decisions, stepping forward and getting baptized, because that's a difficult thing for adult men to do. And so we're seeing that. And so that's one of the core things that we believe is strategically important and it's biblical, because as men, we are the faith leaders of the home. And so to see men say, hey, I'm taking this step of responsibility, I'm renewing my faith or having new faith, and so in that, getting baptized and baptizing their wife or kids, seeing those things. There's nothing more exciting to me than that. And so continue again to see God transform this church and to transform, more importantly, these individuals and family legacies and family heritage. And so that's exciting things to me. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 28. Our mission here, or Matthew chapter 22, sorry. Our mission here is to know Jesus and to make Jesus known. And we talked about it quite a bit, but I just want to remind you, to know is an experiential knowledge. It's literally that you've kind of jumped into the lake, you've jumped into the water, and you're submersed in him. And that it's a complete knowledge. To know Jesus is to complete knowledge. And he literally says, taste and to see that it's good. That it's an experiential type thing. And so someone who has come to know Jesus, it's one of those things that we know that we know that we know that we've entered into a relationship with him, and he's transforming and working in us. And so that the only way that someone else can know and experience what we've experienced is to say yes to Jesus and to let God begin to enter into their life and into their heart and their soul and to begin to transform them. Now, one of the things that we're really good at, in particular at Baptist churches, is that we're really good at Bible studies and gathering people for Bible studies. But what I want you to grasp here is that at second, we're going to teach you. We want you to be involved in Bible studies. We want you to learn. But we want this place, whatever this is, this church, this gathering, these life groups, these places to gather together so that you can be centrifuged out, so that you can make Jesus known in your home and in your community and in your world. That if you just gather here and gain information and gain knowledge, you don't apply that knowledge and make a difference in your life and in the lives of those around you, then it's just knowledge. So that knowledge brings power, brings freedom to change you and to transform you. And the very thing that we need to be doing is gathering together, experiencing, understanding, and gaining more knowledge about who Jesus is and what he wants to do in our life. And then therefore going and centrifuging out and loving for and caring for our neighbors and seeing people transform. One of the main things that we hear as Christians is that we are hypocrites. You ever heard that? That we are hypocrites, that we are good at play acting, basically. In other words, that we gather on Sunday and we give up our time and we learn all this stuff and then we go out into the world and there's nothing different about us. And so that the world is looking at us, what that tells us or should tell us is that the world is looking at us as followers of Jesus and it's expecting and anticipating us to be different. That there should be something different about us because we are saying we're committed to this way of life called Jesus. And so that if we're committed to this way of life called Jesus, actually the way is what they called in the early church. And so that if they saw the way, and as people saw these people that were coming and encountering Jesus and their lives were being transformed, that people were seeing them were saying, hey, listen, I want to be a part of that movement. I want to be a part of that group. I know it's radical. I know that it seems crazy, but I want to be a part of that group because there's something radically different about them. So for us, that's the whole thing, is that we come and we gather here and we gain and we do family and we learn and we worship and we sing songs and we point and align our hearts with Jesus. We align our hearts and our minds with Jesus and our souls with Jesus. That's why we gather together and we're encouraged by the fact that, hey, we're no perfect people are allowed here and we're on a journey together, but everybody matters to God. And so we're centrifuged out. So when we sit next to someone in our cubicle, that we've gained this knowledge that now we can share with someone else. And part of the thing that they're looking at our lives and saying, listen, are they truly followers of the way or are they play actors? And that's that tension that we've been talking about over the last few weeks with this idea of Christian atheism. What does it mean for us to profess Jesus, but then sometimes our lives look actually the opposite? And so even Paul struggled with that he wanted to do what is right, but so many times he pursued what is wrong. And so that we live in this tension. And so again, God talks about that, Paul talks about that, Jesus talks about it, that people are watching us, watching our actions, the way that we treat other people, the way that we love other people. So in Matthew chapter 22, to know Jesus and to make Jesus known. Matthew 22, Jesus here is teaching and he's going around, he's kind of getting toward the end of his ministry, and the religious people have been trying to entrap him. And one of the things that the religious people of the day were, they were really good at, they knew the law inside and out, and they had made extra laws, and they had actually told the people how to interpret the law. And even one of the most radical interpretations of the law was to protect the Sabbath and to rest on the Sabbath so that, you know, if it's your day of rest, you're not supposed to do any work. So one of the interpretations was that if there was a fly flying around your food, you should not take a fly swatter and swat it, but you should somehow or another catch it and then pull all the legs off of it and set it there, and that is how the fly should die. That would require less work than swatting it, because you can't kill on the Sabbath. So you can imagine sitting around going, huh, that's an interesting sermon that I heard today, that I should not swat the fly, I should catch the fly and pull the legs off. And that is the reason that we are here to worship together. So these are the guys that are talking to Jesus and trying to trap Jesus, okay? So these guys spend a lot of time worrying about the minutiae of the religion. And so here Jesus is, and so they ask him this question: hey, teacher, what is the most important commandment? What is the most important thing that as followers of the way, what are we supposed to be doing? And he says this: the very first and most important commandment is to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. In other words, the very main thing that as followers of the way, as followers of God, as followers of Jesus, is we're to pursue God with full abandonment. With everything that we've got, we're to go in and jump. Literally to jump off the edge of the pool and jump into the water and totally be consumed by pursuing Jesus. Now, we have a tendency, as Western thinkers, we have a tendency to put things in silos and kind of like, okay, here's my church life, here's my school life, here's my home life, here's my work life, here's my money life, here's my entertainment life, here's my, you know what I mean? And so we kind of think about all these different things. And so what Jesus is saying is that in pursuit of him, it's an all-encompassing thing. And so as we grow in our relationship with him, he radically transforms how we see all these different ways that we've segmented our life, that everything about our world should be consumed by Jesus. So even the way that we work should be transformed now by our relationship with Jesus. Because if that is true, if our relationship with Jesus is transforming everything, then when we go to work, we don't just see it as a way to earn a paycheck, but we also see it as a way to worship. And so that I work as worship. So when I make money, that's a part of worship. When I work with my coworkers, that's a part of worship. When I think about all the different things that I'm doing, that's worship. When I go to school and I go to the lunchroom, that's worship. When I go to class and I'm studying, that's worship. When I go to the football field, that's worship. When I go to band class, that's worship. That when I go do the things that I do, when I'm at home and we're doing things at home, that's worship. When I go to my entertainment, the entertainment choices and the things that I consume, that's worship. And so that radically transforms as we grow and mature and taste and see that he's good. We realize that some of the things that we pursue and some of the things we're about are not about Jesus and aren't the best for us. They're not necessarily bad, but they're not what God has for us. And so those things begin to slough off. And so here Jesus is saying is that we're being consumed by him and being pursuing him. And that the main way that the world sees that, because they're looking at us, right, and they're saying, hey, these Christians are hypocrites, or these Christians don't follow that way. The number one thing that they're looking at, Jesus follows up with, it's the second commandment. So we're to love God with all we're got, and people see how well we're loving God by our actions and by how we do things. And so the following verse says that, hey, we're to love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and it says the very next thing is to love your neighbor as you love yourself. So it's an interesting idea is that people are watching us and taking into consideration how we love those around us, and they're seeing from us and how we love our neighbor how well we're loving God. Interesting. So whenever people are calling out and saying, hey, we're hypocrites, I think many times what they're saying is that we are not loving well. And that is a condemnation on us, is that many times as a church, we're known for what we're against, not what we're for. We're known for we're against this, and we're against this, and you shouldn't do this, or you should vote this way, or you should do whatever, instead of that we're known for our love, and that we care for, and that we walk with in the messiness of life with people, so that we can see them be transformed by the good news and by the hope of Jesus Christ. And that's what we're to be known for. As a matter of fact, the same story is being told in Luke chapter 10, and Jesus follows this up because the question is asked at the end of, you know, that we're to love our neighbor, and one of those religious guys asks, he's still trying to trip him up, he goes, well, then who's our neighbor? And so then Jesus gives him a story. If you've been around church long enough or VBS, you've heard the story of the Good Samaritan. And so the Good Samaritan comes along, there's Someone who's been beat up and they're along the roadside, and the religious, the priest, comes by and looks at them and says, "Hey, I've got to get to church and I can't get dirty," so they walk by. And the lawyer walks by and says, "Hey, I've got important things to do." And so three people of importance walk by and they look at the person that's in need, and their very thing is, "Listen, I've got to be about me in this moment and not about helping this person and loving this person." The very person that stops and helps is the Samaritan. And the Samaritans are the least of these. They were the outcasts. They were, they were the half-breeds. They were everything, that all the different names that you could possibly throw on someone, they would throw on them. And they were saying, "Hey, this person stopped and helped." And Jesus is saying, "Listen, our number one calling card as followers of Jesus is to love people around us. That we are to be known by the way that we love." As a matter of fact, that's the very reason that the early church grew so rapidly, because people said, "These people of the way are so radically different, the way that they love and they care for." Can y'all bring me another microphone or something? Is that okay? The way that we care for and that we love, it makes us radically different. So people were drawn to that. And so, again, as a church today, more of the time than not, we're known for what we're not for. To know Jesus and what we're known for. And in Matthew chapter 28, Jesus has already been dead and he's resurrected, and he comes before his disciples and he says, "Listen, you're to be loved, and now I give you this new commandment, this new commission for you as followers of Jesus, to go therefore, not just come and sit, but to go therefore and to make disciples of all the nations, of all the peoples, of all the different ones, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them these commandments." And so that one of the things that's important is that we're teaching and we're sharing and we're invading and we're going people, not a sitting people, and not just a gaining of a whole bunch of knowledge. And then also the one thing that I want you to grasp for us here is that in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, is that if we're going to die on a hill as a people, it's going to be Acts chapter 4, verse 12. Thanks. It's annoying, people.
I'm really poppy today. Pop rocks.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right, okay. Now, I move my hands a lot, y'all know, so who knows what will happen. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, this is where we will, as a church, die. I mean, we're going to do things and we're going to pursue things that point people to Jesus. It says, "There is salvation in no one else than Jesus. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved." And so all these things that are going on, all the good things. So right now there's a whole bunch of kids at Awana, and great things are happening at Awana. But the very moment that Awana doesn't point kids to Jesus, we're going to lop that off. And when we're doing all these different things, there's some great things that are happening, but at the very moment that we stop pointing people to Jesus, we're going to stop doing those things. Even the stuff that we do in worship, everything that we do in here is to point you to Jesus. Yes, we may talk about some different themes, we may talk about some different stuff, but what we're trying to help you grasp and what we're trying to help you get is that Jesus is relevant to your life. That you can truly build your life upon that foundation, and that every decision can be filtered through Jesus. The way that you do your finances, the way you do your marriage, the way that you do your dating, the way that you do this, and the way that you do that. Everything can be done. Y'all like that? I can move and do this. Y'all got it? Here we go. It's hand aerobics. And so all of those things, Jesus is the filter through which we do life. And so even when we come in here for worship, one of the things that Hannah and I talk about is, one, do these songs lift up Jesus? And so whether it's an old song or whether it's a new song, we want to point people to Jesus. And so some of the old songs that we sing, guess what? The very tunes that they're sung to are bar tunes from the old days. So the guys would go to the bars on Friday and Saturday night, and they would hear this tune over and over and over again, and somebody would go, "Wow, that's a really cool tune. You know what? I know some truths about Jesus. Let me put those truths to Jesus about this tune." And so now the people go from Friday and Saturday night to the bar, and they go to the church, and they're like, "Wow, I know this tune, and now I can sing these songs," and it magnifies Jesus. And so guess what we're doing still today, hundreds of years later? We're learning these tunes from Beyonce and Jay-Z and Swift Girl, and we're taking these tunes and Hannah Montana, and we're learning all this stuff, and guess what? People are hearing it, and then somebody goes, hey, that's a really cool tune, or something like that, and we put words to Jesus to it, and so now instead of lifting up Beyonce and Jay-Z and all the single ladies, we're lifting up Jesus. And so that's the deal, is what we're trying to do is this, is we're trying to say, listen, all things can be redeemed through Jesus. The most creative people in the world should be Jesus people, because we're followers of him, and God in 6 days did the best creation could ever be, and we enjoy it, and somewhere along the way we've forgotten that God has made us to be creative people, and we need to take back creativity. We need to take back some things that the world has claimed as theirs that is truly ours. And so what we need to be worried about and all this stuff is, are the things that we're doing, are they pointing ourselves and are they pointing others to Jesus? Because listen, there's going to be some songs. Hannah, no, I don't like all the songs. She doesn't like all my sermons. It's okay. There's going to be those things. All right? And so pointing people to Jesus, there is under no other name that we do life and we do ministry. And so I know that that sounds extremely simple, but here's the truth. The gospel is extremely simple. And generation upon generation upon generation has looked at the gospel truth and that you can have life through what Jesus did on the cross. And they've looked at it and they said, there's got to be more than that to this. And so we've added religion. We've done all these different things. And the simple truth is this, that if you believe in what Jesus did on the cross, that he died for you and that your sins can be washed away and that you can have new life through him, that is true. And the reason that I know that it's true, because it's true in my life, and it's true in your life, and in your life, and in your life, and for generations, our world has been radically changed because 11 guys got a hold, Jesus got a hold of 11 guys, and our world has been radically transformed because of those guys. And there's no reason that God can't get a hold of our hearts and our lives here, even in LaGrange in 2018, and radically transform our lives as well. Still 18? What are we in? Okay. Y'all are looking at me like it's 19. Like, don't get ahead of me. All right? So love your neighbor. Here's what I want you to grasp. Over the next few years, there's some cool things going to be happening because of you getting actively involved in what God's doing. And we're out of space. And so we're praying about researching what are we going to do and how can we out of space and what can we do for people? Again, my deal is we need to double down on reaching kids and reaching teenagers, because here's the stat that you need to realize is that most kids, if they're not reached for the gospel, if they've not proclaimed Jesus by the time that they're 13, they're not gonna proclaim. Why? I think because of this. Because there's more accessible to us and to 8, 9, and 10-year-olds than ever before. And I know all the young people are like, oh, but I like my deal. Listen, you have more stuff accessible to you by the time that you're 9 or 10 or 11 or 12 than ever before. And I was even talking with somebody this past week, is the computers, the power of the computers that are in here used to take up this entire room, right? Y'all remember that? Y'all younger people? And then we had those little cards and you could slot those in. And now all this stuff. And so think about how many children have lost their innocence to this. And so we're fighting a battle as followers of Jesus, not against this, but against powers and principalities that we cannot see that use this to weigh our children down, to weigh our students down with pain and shame and regrets and you're not good enough, you never can look this good, you can never achieve this. And so is it any wonder that our young people are giving up their lives and saying, I can't achieve this or do this? And so we're seeing radically things that people are doing. And so what we need to do as a people is to double down and to say, listen, we have got to get into the homes. We've got to get into the schools. We've got to get into these places, and so that we can reach young people for Jesus, so that by the time that they're 13, that they know Jesus and that they're going into high school, right? They're going into high school, and that our high schools and our junior highs are on fire for Jesus. Instead of war zones, that they're places of salt and of light. That's our vision. This place is
is even more than Second Baptist Church. I want this place to be a community center where people are drawn to, and that we're doing things that are for the gospel, and that people want to be a part of what's happening in this place, not because of this place, but because of people here are pursuing Jesus and lives are being transformed. When lives are transformed, people are drawn to that. And that's why this is happening here at Second, is because your lives are being transformed, because we're not doing anything special. We're actually doing some old stuff, and we're just lifting up Jesus and saying, Jesus, you are enough. And we want to filter our lives for that. So here's my challenge for you. One of the most difficult things that we can do is get into groups and get into life accountable things. And so I want to challenge you that especially for us as guys, is to get into some relationships and begin to submit ourselves under other people, so that we can be the men, we can be the leaders that we need to be, into pursuing and into moving in the directions that God wants us to be. So I'm challenging you to get into groups. There's stuff in the back. Find a group. Get involved. Again, you've heard me say this 1,000 times. All of us want us to go, hey, how are you doing? And that be enough. But what we really need is for someone to say, hey, how are you doing? And to know the stuff that you struggle with, and to truly be asking, how are you doing? How are things at? And to know on that gut level that they're not just saying, hey, how are you doing? But they truly know you. And that's where we grow as followers of Jesus. But again, growth doesn't happen alone. It happens in community. And I'm challenging you to grow and to get connected. So God's doing a lot of great things. He's done a lot of great things. And there's some great things ahead that we'll talk about in the next few months and few weeks of what God's going to be doing. But we're excited about where we're at. And we want to tell those stories. So you're going to see more and more stories of people on Sundays of, hey, here's where God's taking me and here's what he's doing in me. So look forward to those. Let's pray together. Dearly Father, thank you so much that you met us where we were at. Reached down and said, you are valuable, you are worthy, you are worth the cost. Father, I thank you for everyone in this room that is in pursuit of you. And I believe that everyone that is here is in pursuit of you. Maybe at different levels, maybe at different stages, maybe at different processes, different ways. But Father, that they're in pursuit of you, and they're in pursuit of truth, and they're in pursuit of freedom. And so, Father, I pray for anyone in this room that is struggling with who is this Jesus, Father, that you would make yourself real and you would make yourself clear to them this morning and this week. That they would know, that they would know that you are enough, that you are sufficient, that what you did on the cross is sufficient. It covers over and carries over anything that they think is too much for you, that you're God and you're big enough and you can handle it. Father, I pray for anyone in this room that just needs to recommit and renew, Father, that they would hear from you that the truth of that you love them and care for them and you want them to come home. That it's time enough of playing in the pig pen and the pigsty and it's looking for scraps whenever you're at home and you're ready for them to run home and that is, you're ready for us. And Father, we just, again, we thank you for what you're doing and continue to do in our midst. And so many lives have been changed and are being changed just through us lifting up Jesus. And Father, you have so much more that you want to do that we cannot even imagine, that if we're just obedient to lifting you up, what you will do. May you be honored and brought glory and fame through what we do. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen. Hey, there's the start of the year. School is starting, all that different stuff. So lots of things are going on. Please look at your program and check all that out. Awanas is starting off. There's a women's Bible study starting off. Student groups are starting off. Sunday morning things are happening. Life groups are taking place. In the back, there's all different kind of life group cards. Take the life group card and find one for you. There's so many different things happening. Prime time is starting. So look at all those different things. Take some notes. Put a little star by it. This is something you want to be involved in. Get connected. Find somebody. Do life with someone. And make the big church, small church, where you can do life with people.
All right, y'all would please stand to continue worship this morning.